This is The Weekly Set, the official podcast of thetotalscreen.com. Episode 169, recorded August 18th, 2018. Hello, everybody, and welcome to The Weekly Set, the official podcast of thetotalscreen.com. I'm your host. My name is Tyson, and joining me today, as always, is my partner in crime here at The Total Screen, William Rorick.
Hello.
So today we are going to continue our discussion of Castle Rock. In particular, we are going to be talking about Season 1, Episode 6, titled Filter. So this episode kind of slowed down a bit after the events of the last couple weeks, I think.
The weird thing is, like I felt like they were trying to, like, explain things, but they just made things more confusing, because I was just like, what?
There's kind of a hint, a whiff of something not that pleasant, which is that over-explaining thing, you know? Like, there's a whiff of midichlorians.
I don't even know what the hell they were talking about, because like you start talking about like something like the voice of God, but like what do you call it? The like schism something with S.
Schisma, I think it's
the called. Schisma, yeah. The schisma. And I'm like,
so the voice of God, the voice of the universe and the all voice of realities and
all that's reality. I'm like, okay, what does that have to do with like this kid they found? What does that have to do with anything, really?
And so I'm we should start pretty much from the beginning, which is we saw in the last episode that Henry had reacquired his father's caskets, and that, you know, the body basically like liquefied because of the, I mean, it's gross. They didn't show it, thankfully, but because of the, like, you know, it's an incident that can occur because of a sealed casket and the gases that build up and stuff. But basically the body liquefied into the casket. They got it there. They were able to rebury it with where the church is, because it's his church, and Henry wanted the body buried there instead of in this like lot out of nowhere where they had moved it because they decided to pave over the old cemetery. Mm-hmm. So Henry got his father moved, and they did like a whole reburial. It was like a new funeral.
Yeah, it was like a brand new funeral.
While that's going on, Henry spies two kind of strange men kind of watching, like standing in front of a trailer.
Right.
And, you know, he's kind of like, what's going on with these guys? They just kind of look a little sketchy. But, like, nothing kind of happens in regards to that, at least not right away.
Right. Well, it's more like, who are those people, right? But then again, like, there's a lot of sketchy things. So it kind of, like, well, for me, like, it kind of just, like, okay, yeah, those people are weird. But then it was like, okay.
This is Castle Rock.
Exactly. This is Castle Rock. So weird people is not new.
So the next kind of thing that happens is Henry's son visits from Boston. We didn't even really know that he had a son up to this point, I don't believe.
I think it was mentioned. It was mentioned before, for sure.
Okay. It wasn't part of the story at all.
No.
And so now he's in Castle Rock, down from Boston. He seems to have some resentment from his father. He'd mentioned that.
We gotta figure, right? Like, you can infer some things that they haven't, like, told you just from the situation, like Henry's in Texas being a death row attorney, and his son is in Boston. That kind of tells you that he's divorced from his wife, mm-hmm. and that his son's living with his mother.
Yes. And apparently Henry hasn't really done much to visit his son, because Henry makes a comment about how it's good that he had come to Castle Rock because he gets to see his grandma, and his grandma can't get up and go to Boston. And his son remarks to that by saying, I guess it's hereditary. Sick burn there about his father being kind of absent, and is Henry's just kind of not too happy about that, and kind of makes his stand against that. But you can see that there's some tension between him and his son. So next up, we saw the way the last episode ended with former Sheriff Pangborn talking to the kid, and the kid implying that he could help his wife, Henry's mother, Ruth. And so when this episode's kind of picking up, Pangborn is visiting a tow yard, or a junkyard, basically. And the idea is that he's on like some mission from the kid to retrieve something. That's kind of what Pangborn's doing throughout this episode.
Right, he's trying to retrieve, which turns out to be the former warden's car that he killed himself in.
Warden Lacey's car that drove off the cliff in.
And, you know, and he doesn't know why he needs this, and the kid is not explaining anything, so...
Yeah, you know. And he's like, well, the car's being moved over here, and the kid's like, well, then you better go over there. And he's like, I have to take care of Ruth. I have other things I have to do, other obligations. And he's like, well, he's all, if you want to save her, and he says, time is her enemy.
Yeah, he says time is her enemy. Like, very cryptic. Oh, no.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. It's like, okay.
So Pangborn's kind of like, okay, well, then this takes priority. And that's kind of his pursuit through the rest of the episode.
In the meantime, Henry takes the kid and drops him off at a mental hospital, Juniper Hall, because they're ready to receive him.
Yeah. You like the kid walking around the forest in a suit, like, way too big for him?
Yeah.
in before he even drops him off, though, the kid finds some videotapes
Henry's dad had made with Henry, like, in
of them, like, walking into the woods.
Walking into the woods, and Henry's dad says something about hearing the voice of God, you know, like some weird shit.
This ends up pushing Henry to visit Molly
because
he knows she lives nearby and he knows, like, something's going on with her. So he's like, hey, did you know anything about this, about these trips in the woods I was taking? He's like, I don't remember any of this.
And she explains that she knew about it because of her psychic connection to Henry. Mm-hmm. And then she also confesses that she killed his father.
She adds a new wrinkle to that, though.
She adds a new wrinkle, though, because she said, like, because of she said it's like she did because of her connection, and so, like, almost like Henry did it through her is how she put it.
Like, Henry controlled her body, and she had mentioned that after she did it, she looked down at her hand and it was Henry's hand or something.
Yeah, Henry's hand. This causes Henry to get pissed and call her.
He's kind of like, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, what
the fuck drugs are you on? Jesus, I'm out of here. Laters.
We should mention while all this is going on, Henry's son is talking to Ruth, Henry's mom.
Yeah, Ruth is talking about being, like, displaced in time.
How she's kind of like, she's seeing things from before and seeing things from after, and just kind of...
She says she's using the chess pieces as, like, an anchor to anchor her back to where she is, you know? Like, she says she sees it, when she sees a chess piece, then she knows that she's in the present, and whatever she's experiencing wasn't real.
Mm-hmm. So she's kind of talking to Henry's son about this, and Henry's son's kind of like, oh, okay. Crazy lady, get me out of here, Dad. But so all that stuff's going on. As we had mentioned, Henry had dropped off the kid at the kind of mental hospital place called Juniper Hall. The kid quickly escapes from that, but that's...
Henry thinks he's finally done with them.
Yeah. we'll get to that later, but the kid eventually escapes from that. But after Henry has this little talk with Molly, he gets those videotapes and he starts trying to kind of cruise through the woods and kind of, like, retrace his steps. And this is kind of, like, leads us to the kind of the biggest moment of the episode, really, which is while he's retracing his steps, he ends up, I think it's like on a second trip, because the first trip, the battery dies on the camera. And the second trip, I think he had transferred it to his cell phone or something so it could last long enough for him to walk through the forest and find where it went. And he retraces his steps there, and he ends up seeing that trailer that we had seen at the funeral, and a guy sitting outside of one of the two men is sitting outside, like, tending to a campfire. And Henry kind of, like, walks up and approaches him, and the guy like, freaks out. It's Kieran Culkin, by the way, Macaulay Culkin's brother, playing that kid.
Oh, I did not make the connection.
Yeah, but he's he's freaking out, and he's kind of like a little bit off put, and Henry's like, whoa, whoa, calm down. Then the other guy comes out.
Yeah.
And we find out quickly that he's deaf.
He's deaf. And Kieran Culkin is like his translator.
Yeah. And so we find out their names. The Kieran Culkin's character's name is Willie, and the deaf guy's name is Odin. And
this is where we get like all this weird like lore or whatever that like doesn't...
Well, Odin mentions...
invites more questions than answers. Really?
I'm saying that Odin says he's surprised that Henry didn't have the funeral in the forest.
Right.
Because he says that the forest was his father's church.
Right.
And then they talk about the connection that they have together and the research they did. And Odin's...
Apparently, Odin and Henry's father became obsessed with this something called the schisma.
Yeah, the voice of God or all things in the universe.
Right.
And Henry's dad was obviously into it from his religious convictions.
And that's what...
Odin claimed...
That's literally what the tapes with Henry and his dad were about.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Odin at least claims that he has like several PhDs and he's like a renowned like scientist or something, and that he's interested in it for like these scientific reasonings. This could all be bullshit for all we
know.
Yeah,
we
anybody can
this.
Say I have 10 PhDs and blah blah blah. You know, it's like,
oh yeah, especially when you're like a deaf crackpot like in the fucking woods, right? Like talking about
weird like hickish looking sidekick.
Yeah, you definitely seem like an authority on fucking creep. Bullshit. So
Odin gets Henry to go into his trailer and for kind of like a deeper explanation. And Odin kind of like talks about how, you know, when you can, people will hear like the voice of God or the voice of the universe or whatever it is, the schisma, as he calls it, and like not have any idea what it is. And then the one way he hooks Henry is he says, sometimes it appears as a ringing in your ear.
Yeah.
Which is something that Henry's been dealing with for the last couple episodes, at least. They've been talking about like him going to a doctor because he thinks he might have tinnitus, which is like a ringing in your ear that you get from, you know, loud noises and stuff like that it can cause that in you.
Except Henry doesn't have any, like, Henry doesn't have, like, any point where he said, yeah, I listen to music too loud and I have tinnitus. Like, he's had it since he was a kid and he doesn't, like, really understand why he has it.
So this is kind of like rings a little bit of truth to Henry. He's like, okay, maybe there's something here. Then Odin starts kind of dipping into slightly crazier territory. He starts talking about he has like this isolation chamber built into his camper that is like the quietest place on basically the entire planet because he uses proprietary technology as along with like, you know, designed like sound muffling foam to stop like, you know, any sound at all from coming out when this door in this trailer is closed to this back room. But then the craziest thing is he starts talking about making the ultimate sacrifice to hear the schisma to block out other sound, making the direct implication that he took his own hearing away.
He took his own hearing away. So because he said like he said he can't, you can't really hear the schisma. Most people, I guess he explained, like, everybody can hear the schisma, but most people can't hear it because the sound of the world, or, like, the noise of the world drowns it out, is the way, like, he explained it. And he said, like, people like Henry with the tinnitus, it's like, they're hearing it, you know, they're hearing it, like, better, they're more attuned to it than, like, most people, but you still can't really hear it because of the noise of the world, that's why it's a ringing in your ear. And so, he said the only way to truly hear it is to drown out all other sound. And that's why he made that room. And yeah, that's why he made himself deaf. So that, I guess his reasoning is if he's deaf, then the schisma will be the only thing that he can hear. Mm-hmm. And he'll be able to truly hear it.
And he also references saying that Henry's father is the one that basically came up for the design for the sound isolation room, but had never been able to build it.
Right.
Before he died. And then, he had He also mentions in all of this that the reason they're out in the forest is to hear the schisma and also for Willie's correction, as he calls it, I believe.
Which
we're kind of like, okay, what the
hell? Whatever the hell that is.
It seems to be, at the point, at our last hearing of it, it seems to be the implication that he's going to do the same thing to Willie that he did to himself to take away his hearing.
Right.
That
right.
seems to be with the implication, that which is kind of dark.
Yeah, it's kind of
cultish, you know. It's kind of like creepy. But then while he's showing the room to Henry, and Henry's like, "What? I didn't agree to." He's like talking about the room. He's all, "Oh, and when you're in here, you're gonna hear the voice of God yourself." And Henry's like, "I didn't agree to go in here."
Yeah, Henry's like, "I don't know about this shit. I'm probably just gonna leave." But then they manage to convince Henry to step in there, and that's when he locks Henry in there.
Yeah, Henry's like, "Well, I'm not gonna stay in here," and Odin just like shuts the door really quickly and locks it.
Yeah.
And
then all of a sudden, like, the ringing that Henry experiences gets substantially louder.
There's some voice that starts coming through, and
there's like these visions that, like, I don't even know, like, because it's just like, it was just like a bunch of things that don't make sense.
He's going into like hallucinogenic chaos, basically.
Yeah, hallucinogenic chaos. Like, it looked like he was like in like actual pain.
Yeah, he was like screaming and yeah, he's like screaming and kind of doubling over in pain, and just kind of, it's like the immediately when the door shut, like, it's like basically his mind like broke or something. It's really weird.
Yeah, and while Henry's going through that, Sheriff Pangborn arrives home with the car, and he sees the kid, and the kid is like talking about, like, you know, like, I don't know, he's just babbling nonsense. And
he asks the kid what the car's for.
Yeah,
and the kid finally says, he says it's a monument for the warden.
Yeah, he says it's a monument for the warden. Yeah, that's what he says. And then, like, you notice, like, he's cut, or he has, like, blood on his hand, on his wrist.
And then as he notices he has a lot more blood on him.
He has a lot more blood on him. And then he goes into the house, and the house is, like, all wrecked and stuff. And, you know, like, there's like blood all over the place, and
the implication is that he killed Ruth.
Yeah, the implication is that he killed Ruth.
We don't see it. So
because the episode decides to end
right because there. That's the implication, and because we don't see it, it probably isn't what happened.
Right, yeah, because if it was what happened, I think if it's what actually happened, they would have ended on a shot of Ruth's body. But since we don't see like her body, I'm pretty sure that's not what happened.
It just means they're leading us to believe that. Without actually doing it. But probably the most interesting thing here is that before the sheriff goes into the house, the last thing the kid says to him is, "Why would you leave me in that trunk, Sheriff?"
Yeah, yeah. Which again leads you to a conclusion that he did something like he killed Ruth out of revenge, right? That's what that line is supposed to lead you to believe.
Yeah, like, you know, you left me in that. It could, there's like two implications of what that could mean. One is that he's saying, "Why did you do this?" as like a confrontation, like, this is kind of like my revenge on you for that. And the other sense is that he's reminding the sheriff of why the sheriff followed his instincts and left him in the trunk in the first place.
Right, right.
He's saying, like, two ways. Like, you should have known better. You left me in that trunk for a reason.
Actually, now you make sense. Now that you bring it up, that makes sense, because that car that he had Sheriff Pangborn recover was the car that he was in the trunk of, right?
Yes.
It was the same car.
As far as we know. Got a new car.
So that's probably why he really had him go get that car, because it had significance to him because he was in the trunk of that car. Still can't make sense of it, but
yeah, it's kind of cryptic and weird, and there's lots of implications going on, and a lot of those implications, if you kind of know how to follow a narrative and know kind of like the way, especially like a show like this has progressed already, a lot of those implications are probably false flags,
right?
They're leading us to think something that's not the case. Like it's weird to end without showing Ruth's body, unless like that's not the case, that she's not dead or something, you know?
Right, right. Right.
That it has to be something else, you know.
They're leading you to an implication of something.
Yeah, but without giving you certain key details that makes it seem a little off. Like, makes you go like, but wait a minute, why didn't they do this then? You know, like, that doesn't make sense. Like, why wouldn't they give you that closure of sadness and actually knowing that she's dead or something if she is dead? Like, that's what you would do, you know, typically. So either they're subverting what would naturally be done, or they're misleading us. You know, it's got to be one or the other, you know, because it's showing the body what would normally be done, or having him like look down and you see his face and he says her name or something like that, like he's seeing her. That's the implication that would let you know for sure. But they're either misleading us or they're subverting the typical standard of what you would do in that situation in an episode. So, and we just don't know what it is.
Right. Again, it's another cliffhanger, which we know by now this show loves cliffhangers, right?
So, yeah.
So it's like...
It's a streaming show.
You better come back next week.
Remember that Hulu does have ad break. You don't pay for the full streaming thing, because it's doing something that you don't see that often on streaming shows, which is it'll have these like commercial break moments where like it things come to like this mini cliffhanger and it's like, oh my God, what's going to happen? And it cuts to black and then it goes to the next scene. If you're watching on Hulu ad-free, you're just watching it as a whole episode. But if you're watching it on like the first tier, which is like with limited ads, there's ads in that space.
Right, that's true.
But it's not something that we normally see.
I forget that because I have the ad-free tier. So.
Exactly. So it's weird. Like, I remember being a little weirded out by those when I was first watching the show, because I'm like, why are they doing these little ad break mini cliffhangers?
Yeah.
Like, you know, why are they doing that? There's no
way. So, in that way, like, it's filmed and structured like a standard network show.
Yes.
Which is weird. Like, you know? Yeah, it's a little weird.
For a streaming show, like, it just it's not the norm for what a streaming show does, but this wasn't one of those cliffhangers. This was an actual end of episode.
This was the end of it. This was you better come back next week type cliffhanger.
Yeah. So what did you think of this episode overall? Because, like, I'll say up front that, I don't know, like I said, I'm getting a bit of a midichlorian whiff with the whole schisma
thing. Yeah, the whole schisma thing, like, sounds suspect. Like, my opinion is fair. Like, if the schisma turns out to be, like, something cool and not just something stupid that, like, they pulled out of their ass, like, mid-season, it'd be fine. It could also explain some things, like, about the kid. Maybe the problem with the kid is, like, he's just attuned to the schisma, like, more than anybody else, and he's, like, an instrument, and, like he can point the schisma at other things. You know, that would kind of explain how, like, he influences people around him, I guess.
Do you mind if I spoil something from The Leftovers right now?
Go ahead.
Okay, so in season two of The Leftovers, there's, like, a kind of a similar theme of, like, setting up, like, okay, there's some guy and he's talking some crazy talk about something. Like, in the case of Castle Rock, it's a schisma. And this thing, it's this guy talking about piercing the veil between life and death and, like, you know, and then coming back kind of thing. And he convinces this guy to do it. And you're like, okay, so what are they going to do? That's weird. And so he convinces the guy, like, after a lot of work, and I should note right off the bat that The Leftovers is a Damon Lindelof show, who was one of the showrunners on Lost, which was co-created with Damon Lindelof and J.J. Abrams, and J.J. Abrams is one of the co-creators of Castle Rock. So that's why I'm bringing this up, because there's, like, you can see, like, a parallel in the story structuring process. But what they did on The Leftovers that was so crazy was, after the guy convinced the main character essentially to, like, poison himself, and, like, that this guy would watch over him and bring him back, you know, before his body fully died, like, right after the guy, like, went down on the ground and, like, it's like, oh, he's out, it lingered on the guy who did it to him, rather than going, you know, to wherever he went in his headspace, and the guy who did that to him killed himself, like, right then. So it's like, it's kind of like a what the fuck. Like, this guy just said that he'd, like, fish fish him out and save him from dying at the last moment, got him to drink poison, and then fucking blew his own brains out. And it was such like a what the fuck moment, because you're just like, oh my god, the main character is now gonna die because he's like in the situation now, and I won't reveal beyond that because there's all sorts of other kind of stuff, you know. But it's just that moment, and that's how an episode ended, on that moment.
Oh wow,
of just
damn.
like what the fuck. So, and I just kind of like, I got like a little flashback of that in this when he like locked Henry in the trailer, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I'm just saying like if this was like Lindelof doing it, he would have locked him in the trailer, and then him and Willie would have like dumped the trailer into a lake or something. And he'd be like, wait a minute, what about the schisma stuff? Oh, I guess it was all bullshit, or was it not? I don't know. What the fuck's going on? I just wanted to bring that up just because I felt there was like a parallel there. I think The Leftovers did it better, though. They really fucked with the audience because it was like, oh my god, what's the fuck just happened? But yeah, I mean, is there anything else to even kind of like mention about this episode? It was kind of like slower than the last couple.
I think we said everything that we mentioned everything. Like,
yeah, I mean, there's nothing really beyond that too much that,
yeah, otherwise,
really to read into or anything. I mean, we already kind of talked about what the schisma could be and stuff, and you know, maybe it's connected to The Shining, you know, like Molly has The Shining, you know, so maybe there's some kind of connection to that. And but yeah, there's not too much to talk about. This is a weird episode to talk about.
It is.
We're actually recording this late, and part of the reason why is after I finished this episode, I was kind of like lost as to what to talk about.
You and me both, actually. Like, I was kind of like, eh.
I had to like take a break, write up some show notes about what actually happened.
It's like, this schisma shit is like really weird and out of left field all of a sudden.
Yeah.
You know, they just come at you with this shit. I'm just like, what? I just didn't know what to think after I saw it.
Oh, I just looked at something. I have to correct myself. It wasn't Kieran Culkin that played Willie. It's Rory Culkin, which is another one of the Culkin brothers. Well, there's three of them. So
they look practically identical. So
it's still Macaulay Culkin's brother. It's just a different brother.
If I'm not mistaken, I think all three of them were in Home Alone, by the way. Like,
I think so. I think, like, you know, but the other two were only like in bit roles.
Yeah. They're only in bit roles. They were part of like Kevin's like ridiculously large, like family.
Extended family, yeah. But yeah, so, okay, that's Castle Rock. So all that we have left now is talk about what's coming up in the week ahead. So I said we record this a day late. We're recording this on Saturday. So Friday already happened. On Friday, August 17th, 2018, two shows came to Netflix, Ultraviolet and Disenchantment. Disenchantment being the big one. That's the...
Yeah, that's a new Matt Groening cartoon comedy show.
Of course, Matt Groening, the creator of The Simpsons and Futurama.
That goes without saying. Like,
yeah. for those, like, I guess maybe like millennials that didn't grow up with The Simpsons might not even know the name.
That's true.
You might know the show, but not the name, you know?
That's true, yeah. That's true. But like, yeah, this is a big deal because Simpsons obviously was a cultural phenomenon, and Futurama, while not quite as successful as The Simpsons, is still a very beloved show, you know, by a smaller group of people.
I think Futurama at least has the credit of like always being good.
Yeah.
Whereas The Simpsons like went way down in quality. Like,
yeah,
The Simpsons has been bad longer than it's been good.
So this,
I mean, so it's at like 30 years, I think, or something.
So this is the third series. Right now, as far as I haven't watched any myself.
I've seen the first four.
Opinions are mixed so far.
Yeah, I've seen the first four, and it's a little bit weird.
The Simpsons was pretty rough starting out. Futurama was pretty rough starting out. Seems to be the way these things go, right?
That's what I'm hoping is the case. I'm hoping that it picks up more as it goes along. But we're probably almost certainly going to be discussing this in a later podcast. So I'm not going to go into too much detail about my thoughts on it, just because we're going to do a podcast where we go over this after we finish all the Castle Rock podcasts.
Right.
So we'll get to that later. Also coming out this week, we talked about Castle Rock. Well, on Wednesday, August 22nd, 2018, Mr. Mercedes returns to DirecTV and AT&T Audience Network, whatever AT&T calls it that week. Their little like exclusive channel. I bring up Castle Rock with it because Mr. Mercedes.
Well, Mr. Mercedes. Hades is based on a Stephen King novel.
Yes.
That's another. And I believe there's an actor from, like, or there's some kind of Mr. Mercedes reference in Castle Rock, I believe.
I wouldn't doubt it. But it's another Stephen King show. So if Castle Rock isn't enough Stephen King for you, Mr. Mercedes is back for, I believe it's its third season on Wednesday, August 22nd. Then on Thursday, August 23rd, 2018, Deadwood comes to Netflix. I really don't know what that is. But then Rob Riggle's Ski Master Academy comes to Crackle, which is Sony's free streaming service. It's free but ad-supported streaming service. They have a few shows on there, but this is like a Rob Riggle, comedian Rob Riggle.
If you remember him.
It's Rob Riggle's Ski Master Academy. That kind of says it all, right?
Yeah, right.
So that might be fun. We're checking out. And then next Friday, August 24th, 2018, Safe Harbor comes to Hulu. It's Hulu's next original. And Netflix has two new shows coming. One is called Ghoul, which is another international series. And then they have The Innocents, which I guess is technically also an international series, but kind of a bigger production. That's kind of Netflix's next big show, I guess. Like their next, you know, in the line of like Disenchantment being the big one from this week, you know. Innocence is the big one for next week. And that's another one that we talked about that we're probably going to be discussing sometime after Castle Rock is concluded. But yeah, that's it. That's Friday, August 24th. That's what's coming up in the next week. So you can follow us on Twitter. I'm at Tyson Gifford. You can follow Will. He is at Voxel Hero. You can check out our Facebook page and our YouTube channel, as well as our site, thetotalscreen.com. You can subscribe to this podcast through any major podcast client like iTunes or Pocket Cast. And the entire backlog of our podcast is available on our YouTube channel. As I mentioned, next week we're continuing Castle Rock discussion. So if you want to keep up with us, that's going to be episode 7 of Castle Rock next week, I believe. Episode 7 of Castle Rock next week. So thank you everybody for listening. Good night.
Good night.
If you would like to reach out to us and make a comment, send an email to contact@thetotalscreen.com. Stay tuned to The Total Screen for the very best.